Matter of consideration of the 2016 particulate matter SIP for the San Joaquin Valley. And before we take up the staff report on this item, I would be remiss if I didn't thank Dr. Sheriffs, who not only serves on our board, but serves on the San Joaquin Valley board, and who I think ought to at least be allowed a few minutes of introduction here before we take up this item.
Thank you for that. I'm the homeboy. This is my neighborhood, and welcome to my neighborhood. And I really do want to thank everybody for coming, and thank Syed and the Air District for helping out make this possible. I think it's a great example. We get to see some faces we don't usually see. Sacramento's a long way away when people testify, and it's great for the board to have an opportunity to go to different districts and get input from people who may have much more difficulty coming to Sacramento to testify, although we always welcome written comments. But it's also an example, I think, of our board making its best decisions when we get that broad input. And another example of that was the opportunity by coming here that board members had yesterday to tour and learn more about biomass industry issues, and also to tour with the dairy industry, looking at methane digesters. And I think that kind of depth of understanding leads to much better decisions from here. So again, thanking all. And I do have to shout out Kevin Abernathy with Dairy Cares for his organization of the tour with the dairy yesterday. I think we all found it very, very helpful, very enlightening. So thank you all for coming. And
thank you so much. And for the warm welcome we've received here, we are grateful. I'm really sorry. I personally wasn't able to attend the tour yesterday because biomass is going to be a topic of conversation.
I have 83 pictures that I could.
But you can send them to me as a file.
Madam Chair, yeah. If I might, I echo the great opportunity that we had yesterday and as well today to meet with this district's residents. But yesterday, the tour that Kevin arranged with Dr. Sheriffs was very valuable. And he just said to me, as I thanked him again for that opportunity, that he would make that available again for board members that weren't able to go. Timing was critical. It's sometimes flight patterns are very difficult for people to get to Fresno at the right time because there's a limited number of planes. And so he's made that offer, and I would encourage everybody to take that offer.
Thank you.
And work with him.
Thank you so much. If there are people in the audience here who have not signed up to testify and who are planning to testify or think they're going to testify, I would really encourage you to put your name on the list because we need to organize our time here to make sure that we have enough time and that we can, if at all possible, consider this entire item as a package before we take a lunch break. So. Now I think we should probably begin. Mr. Corey, would you introduce this item?
Yes, Chair Nichols. And the Clean Air Act sets out a stepwise planning process for developing PM2.5 state implementation plans. This process starts with a moderate area SIP with an initial attainment deadline within 6 years. If the attainment within this time frame is impractical, EPA classifies the area as serious and requires a second SIP that must show attainment within 10 years. PM2.5 levels in the valley have shown overall improvement since 2001. However, weather conditions associated with the recent California drought held up progress towards attainment. These drought-impacted PM2.5 concentrations make it infeasible for the valley to attain the 12 microgram per cubic meter annual standard by 2021 moderate area deadline. The 2016 PM2.5 SIP was therefore developed to fulfill the first step established in the Clean Air Act planning process. The plan includes an impracticality demonstration and a request to be classified as a serious non-attainment area. Looking beyond today's item, ARB staff is working with the San Joaquin Valley Air District on evaluating the region's attainment needs. Today's presentation will explore the nature of the Valley's PM2.5 problem and contributing sources, setting the stage for your consideration of a serious area attainment plan next year. I'll now ask Webster Tassat, manager of the Central Valley Air Quality Planning Section in the Air Quality Planning and Science Division, to give the staff presentation. Webster.
Thank you, Mr. Corey. Good morning, Chair Nichols and members of the board. Meeting PM2.5 standards over the next decade is the Valley's most critical air quality challenge. In today's presentation, I'll begin with an overview of the approach for defining a comprehensive attainment strategy for the region that staff and the Air District will be working on over the next 12 months. Next, I'll discuss the SIP for you today and the role it plays in this broader planning process. The focus of the remaining presentation will then look at the nature of PM2.5 in the Valley and how this science is informing the strategies that will be needed. Finally, I'll highlight several broad new initiatives that are supporting the Valley's transformation to a cleaner, more sustainable future. I'll start with an overview of the Valley's path to attainment and how today's SIP fits into the Clean Air Act's planning framework. The Clean Air Act sets out requirements for establishing air quality standards, as well as the plans for meeting them. EPA is also required to periodically review standards to ensure they remain protective of public health. Based on this review, EPA has established increasingly health-protective PM2.5 standards. This includes both a daily standard to protect against short-term exposure and an annual standard to address chronic health effects. Over the next decade, the Valley must meet the daily standard of 35 micrograms per cubic meter, the original standard of 15 micrograms per cubic meter, and the most recent revision, which lowered the annual standard to 12 micrograms per cubic meter. Rather than individual strategies for each standard, we are working to develop a comprehensive strategy on an accelerated schedule addressing all of these standards. This will build on current progress. For example, annual levels have dropped over 15% since 2001. And peak daily levels have decreased 25%. The Clean Air Act's health-based air quality standards, meaningful deadlines, and requirements for comprehensive plans have been the tool for achieving this air quality success. The Act's flexibility to tailor control strategies to best fit California's needs also provides an effective framework for future planning. The Valley's PM2.5 attainment strategy will need to include both regulatory efforts and incentive programs reflecting comprehensive actions by both ARB and the district. Work has already begun to identify key sources and the types of strategies that will be needed, as I'll highlight today. Over the next year, this information will provide the basis for developing specific regulations and other actions that will be required to achieve healthy air. Development of the strategy must also include a robust public process to engage all Valley stakeholders. ARB staff are committed to working with the district to initiate the public process as soon as possible. As we continue to work on the comprehensive attainment strategy, there are also interim requirements for individual standards. The proposed action today addresses that interim step for the most recent annual standard of 12 micrograms. Under the Clean Air Act, areas with more severe air quality are provided more time to attain, along with more stringent control requirements. However, unlike ozone, which sets specific attainment deadlines before the planning process begins, establishing an appropriate attainment date for PM2.5 is a stepwise process, which begins with preparation of a moderate plan. The moderate SIP must include all controls that can be implemented within a six-year time frame, and an evaluation of whether they can provide for attainment by 2021. If a longer time frame is necessary to implement strategies to achieve the needed reductions, a second SIP is required demonstrating how the area will meet the standard by the serious area deadline of 2025. Today's SIP represents the first step required under the Act's phased planning process. The moderate SIP was approved by the District Board last month. Between now and 2021, ARB and the district will continue to implement an aggressive suite of control programs that provide significant reductions. For example, the truck and bus regulation is a key program to reduce NOx and diesel PM emissions. The regulation represents a multi-year effort to turn over the legacy fleet, with nearly all trucks meeting a 2010 engine standard by 2023. For PM2.5, the district's wood burning curtailment rule and burn cleaner program to reduce wood burning devices, to replace wood burning devices with cleaner units, are providing ongoing PM2.5 benefits. Incentive programs are also enhancing the transformation toward cleaner technologies. Since 2009, over $400 million in private and public funding have been invested in the replacement of older agricultural tractors with newer, cleaner models. By 2021, ARB and the district control programs will reduce NOx by nearly 40% and PM2.5 by over 5%. The moderate area SIP requires a modeling assessment to determine the benefits of these substantial emission reductions. This modeling is a collaborative effort between ARB and the district and draws on the scientific studies conducted in the region. The modeling also reflects the increased PM2.5 levels that have occurred due to weather conditions associated with the drought. As shown in the graph on the right, implementation of current control programs will result in significant progress. However, the modeling demonstrates that additional reductions are needed to ensure public health protection under the potential recurrence of drought-type weather patterns. As I'll be discussing in the remaining portion of the presentation, these reductions are achievable and will rely on new actions over the next 10 years. A serious classification provides the suitable time frame under the Act to develop and implement these comprehensive new measures. Today's SIP fulfills a required step in the Clean Air Act planning process and sets the stage for a broader multi-standard strategy development. The SIP includes a request that EPA classify the San Joaquin Valley as serious with an attainment deadline of 2025. The SIP also includes all requirements for a moderate area, including assessment of controls and elements that ensure ongoing progress, including reasonably available control measures, reasonable further progress, and contingency measures. As we move forward on the next step, I'll highlight how our understanding of the nature of PM2.5 in the Valley is informing strategy development. As I mentioned earlier, over the next decade, the Valley must meet a suite of PM2.5 standards. Actions to address these standards are interrelated, and therefore an integrated strategy provides for more efficient planning and progress towards attainment. An integrated strategy must consider the multiple source types that contribute to both daily and annual PM2.5 levels, as well as sources that contribute at different times of the year. Specific measures will be identified as part of the planning process based on continuing modeling, analysis, technology assessments, and stakeholder input. However, in today's presentation, I'll highlight the key sources that contribute to PM2.5 in the Valley and potential strategies for each source. Defining an effective strategy begins with understanding the nature and magnitude of the challenge. The Valley's topography and weather patterns are especially conducive to the formation and accumulation of PM2.5. Mountain ranges on the east and west sides of the Valley and the Tehachapi Mountains to the south trap air pollution year-round. During the winter, long periods without rainfall, coupled with cool temperatures and stagnant winds, lead to PM2.5 levels that build over days to weeks. While these factors produce elevated concentrations valley-wide, the highest PM2.5 concentrations are typically measured in the central and southern portions of the Valley, as illustrated in the map on the right. Weather conditions and seasonal emission activities also lead to PM2.5 levels that vary throughout the year. The graph on the right illustrates monthly average PM2.5 concentrations in Bakersfield, the area with the highest levels. While PM2.5 concentrations are highest during the winter months, almost every month has average concentrations above the 12 microgram annual standard. Meeting this standard therefore requires a year-round strategy with controls on the specific sources that contribute in each season. I'll describe how we identify these sources and associated strategies in the next series of slides. Let's start by looking at the winter months of November through February, highlighted in purple in the graph on the left. Ambient PM2.5 levels are made up of many constituents that can be either directly emitted, such as soot and dust, or formed through reactions of NOx, SOx, and ammonia. Routine measurements of these constituents are made at four sites in the Valley, supplemented with more extensive measurements during intensive field studies. Examining the makeup of PM2.5 at different times of the year helps determine contributing sources and identify effective control approaches. The pie chart on the right shows the average contribution of different constituents to wintertime PM2.5 levels in Bakersfield. Ammonium nitrate, shown in red, and carbon, shown in blue, are the two largest contributors. Together, they comprise nearly 80% of measured PM2.5, and thus, both must be reduced to lower wintertime PM levels. So what are strategy approaches for ammonium nitrate? Ammonium nitrate is a secondary pollutant which forms through the reaction of NOx with ammonia. Extensive studies conducted in the valley demonstrate that controlling NOx is the most effective way to reduce ammonium nitrate. Mobile sources comprise over 80% of NOx emissions in the valley. Thus, measures in ARB's mobile source strategy will be the foundation for the cleaner technologies needed for attainment. Key measures include the new low-NOx standard for heavy-duty trucks, as you just heard in the prior item, requirements for more stringent locomotive engine standards, and specifications for low-emission diesel fuel. Incentive programs will also be critical for accelerating the pace of cleaner technologies within the 2025 timeframe. The low-carbon transportation funding you will hear about next is one such program, but meeting the Valley's needs will require looking beyond current state funding mechanisms. The San Joaquin Valley and South Coast boards have already begun working together to develop funding plans to meet the combined needs of both regions. Wintertime PM2.5 is also made up of large amounts of carbon combustion particles, as shown in the blue slice. Chemical markers that are unique to different sources are used to identify the sources of these particles. These markers demonstrate that both wood burning and commercial cooking operations are significant contributors, as well as diesel PM from mobile sources. In designing the control strategy, it is important to know that reducing these directly emitted particles is up to 10 times more effective in reducing PM than controlling NOx. Strategies for these combustion sources will need to consider the stringency and effective implementation of the district's wood burning curtailment program and continued expansion of incentive programs to replace older wood stoves and fireplaces. Enhanced education and outreach efforts on the use of cleaner burning alternatives, especially in disadvantaged communities, will also be important. The district is also working with restaurants to demonstrate new technologies for reducing emissions from char broiling. Finally, programs to reduce diesel PM will be important for both PM2.5 attainment and in reducing near source exposure. Next, let's look at the summer and fall months, which are now the purple highlighted bars in the chart on the left. Although concentrations are lower than in winter, monthly average concentrations remain above the annual standard. Thus, strategies for sources that predominate in the summer and fall are also needed to meet the standards. As shown in the pie chart on the right, ammonium nitrate and carbon particles still play a role, with carbon particles becoming even more important. But fugitive dust particles, shown in orange, also become a significant contributor during the summer and fall. The contribution of fugitive dust to PM2.5 has typically been small. However, with longer air pollution episodes, drier soil conditions associated with the drought, and an increase in fallow fields, fugitive dust levels have increased in recent years. Reducing PM2.5 concentrations in the summer and fall will therefore require evaluation of opportunities to reduce dust emissions from a variety of sources, including paved and unpaved roads, agricultural operations, and construction areas. Reducing PM2.5 in the summer and fall will also need to include strategies for other constituents. Mobile source NOx reductions provide year-round benefits for ammonium nitrate. The same is true for strategies to reduce combustion particles from commercial cooking and diesel PM. Other more seasonal strategies, however, include contributions from managed burning and biogenic emissions that form secondary organic aerosols. Implementation of the district's smoke management program helps minimize the impacts of burning, but efforts to continue to develop non-burning alternatives for waste residues will also be important. Addressing ammonium sulfate will be more challenging as the sources are smaller and more widely distributed, but the attainment strategy should evaluate potential opportunities for further reductions. In addition to the specific strategies I just discussed, there are a number of new valley initiatives that will provide broad environmental benefits, improving PM2.5 and ozone levels, as well as reducing greenhouse gases. These initiatives support the valley's transition to more sustainable development, greener technologies, and beneficial use of the valley's biomass resources. The next few slides briefly highlight a few of these programs. The Transformative Climate Communities Program, recently signed by Governor Brown, provides grants to fund neighborhood-level planning that includes projects to address climate change and provide other community-scale benefits, particularly for disadvantaged communities. Under the program, $70 million was recently proposed for Fresno and will be invested in numerous projects that will help reduce emissions through regional transportation development and by encouraging the use of public transit and other modes of transportation. This is an exciting opportunity for the city and can be the foundation for long-term transformation and development. ARB will also be partnering with multiple stakeholders to develop both short-term and long-term strategies for transitioning away from biomass combustion to more efficient and cleaner technologies and disposal methods. A biomass utilization action plan will explore the opportunities to better utilize biomass for composting and generating renewable fuels and bioenergy, both from agricultural and forest biomass. This effort, led by Board Member Flores, will include a biomass summit planned for next spring. The first of several comprehensive planning meetings took place just yesterday in Bakersfield. The initial focus of this effort will be on developing near-term solutions for alternatives to agricultural burning in the San Joaquin Valley. The increased use of renewable natural gas also has the potential to provide significant benefits in the valley. Actions include a number of pilot projects to demonstrate the viability of producing renewable natural gas from agricultural, forestry, and other biomass waste streams. Renewable natural gas can displace fossil fuels and use organic waste from a variety of sources, including landfills, wastewater treatment plants, and livestock operations. For example, a major biogas project deriving energy from dairy waste is currently in operation in Tulare County. Efforts to bring pipeline distribution of renewable natural gas to rural residents in the valley could also provide opportunities for meeting home heating needs through a cleaner fuel source. Over the next year, ARB will be working with the district to develop specific measures as part of an integrated attainment strategy. The strategy will need to reflect a comprehensive portfolio of actions targeting the diversity of sources that contribute to PM2.5 throughout the year. The actions and cleaner technologies that will be needed are already underway. ARB staff will be holding the first workshop on development of the low NOx truck standard next month, and EPA has signaled their intent to work with ARB on a harmonized national approach. Cleaner wood stove standards established by EPA will be in place by 2020, and research projects are underway to demonstrate new methods for controlling emissions from commercial restaurants. At the same time, incentive programs and broad initiatives such as the Transformative Climate Communities are integrating efforts to support both air quality and climate goals. Combined ARB and district action will be essential in achieving healthful air. ARB rulemaking over the next few years, as outlined in the Mobile Source Strategy, will establish requirements for cleaner engine standards and zero-emission technologies. Incentive programs will need to complement these efforts by accelerating the deployment of cleaner technologies to meet PM2.5 attainment timeframes. District actions must consider strategies for sources under local jurisdictions, such as wood burning and fugitive dust, along with strong partnership with ARB in implementing incentive programs. In closing, staff will continue working with the district on an accelerated schedule for development of a comprehensive attainment strategy for the Valley that we will bring back for your consideration next fall. This will include initiation of a public process to actively involve all Valley stakeholders. Staff also recommends approval of the moderate PM2.5 SIP for the 12 microgram standard as required under the Clean Air Act to address the first step in the planning process. This concludes my presentation, and we would be happy to answer any questions you might have.
I think we should probably hear next from the district, and then we can have our questions.
We accommodate short people here, so I'm Lawrence.
Ah, well done. I need one of those.
We should have one.
Thank you, Madam Chair, members of the board. Let me also officially welcome you on behalf of the Air Board here, Valley residents to be here in San Joaquin Valley. Thank you for being here. please come back again. We really value our partnership, the great work that you do for us, both in terms of holding our feet to the fire to do everything possible within our means, and then doing everything that you can to make sure we save lives in San Joaquin Valley. Your work over the years to save lives in San Joaquin Valley does not go unnoticed, and there has been a lot of progress that that we are grateful because of your assistance. And I also wanted to specifically thank Richard Corey for always paying attention to our needs. All of my colleagues through CAPCOA, the California Air Pollution Control Officers Association, we really appreciate the time and devotion that he has shown in understanding our issues and helping us move forward with all the things that we need to do. Now, with respect to the item that is before us today, if you could put the PowerPoint on. Okay. All right. Thank you. This item, by the way, was unanimously approved by the board. Dr. Sheriffs was there. It came with a together with a, after a lengthy public process, a number of public hearings, public meetings, and where everyone's input was taken into account. And at the final hearing last month, my friends from the environmental advocacy groups were here, and no one had any opposition. They did not even ask for a delay, because sometimes my friends there, when they cannot come up with a specific objection that they have, they say, well, let's just delay it and think about it some more. At that meeting, there was no objection to the plan, and there was no ask for delay. Now, this plan that is before you, as your staff very well articulated, a big part of it is a demonstration that attainment is impracticable. That's a legal requirement. We also have to show that we have reasonable available control technology. As you know, we, both the district and you, we have been in a perpetual planning mode for PM, and EPA just last year made a ruling that we have reasonable available control technology. In fact, we have best available control measures, which are so-called BACM, that go well beyond reasonable control technology. In my opinion, this is a bureaucratic process that we have to go through, and I'm hoping today we don't spend a lot of time on that part of it. I'm going to show you some charts that deal with the impracticability issue, but my hope is that we can spend a lot of our time today on doing things that actually save lives in San Joaquin Valley, reduce air pollution, moving forward to actually get some things done. So with that, let me just show you this chart. The bar to the left is the baseline inventory, where we are. 2021 is where we're going to be with all the measures that you have put in place and all the things that we're doing locally. As you can see, the orange part, which is the stationary source emissions, make up only 15% of the total pollution. And that is all of agriculture, all of oil industry operations, dairies, every business that you can think of in San Joaquin Valley. That's the total air pollution that we get from stationary sources. As you can see, trucks are a big part of our inventory. Over 85% of the pollution comes from mobile sources. And as you can tell, not only it's impracticable, it's really physically impossible to show attainment by 2021. And that red bar is where we need to go to reduce air pollution, NOx emissions, to show attainment. As you can tell, if I eliminated all of our stationary sources in San Joaquin Valley, we're not going to be able to attain. If we eliminated all the trucks, we're not going to be able to meet the standard. We need a lot of reductions in emissions from all source categories. Now, if you approve this item that is before you and we send it to EPA, then the deadline of 2025 is not a lot easier. But at this point, we're not ready to raise the white flag and say it's impossible. I think we have to do everything we can to see if we can there. But there are some people that say even 2025 might be impossible. But we have high hopes that we can get there. As your staff said, technology might be there. The infrastructure needs a lot of work to be able to get to zero emissions. But basically, for the Valley to meet the standard, we need to get to a point of zero emissions from fossil fuel combustion. Now, I'm not talking about banning fossil fuel combustion, but we need the technologies where we can get to pretty low emissions from fossil fuel combustion. So hopefully that's very clear that, you know, this is not an unnecessary delay. For the ozone, for instance, EPA has already put implementation rules in place that says if you are an extreme non-attainment for a much easier standard, when they publish the tougher standards, you by default are considered to be extreme for a more difficult standard. Here, the Valley's already been designated as serious non-attainment for the 1997 standard, serious non-attainment for the 2006 standard, and really to spend a lot of time to prove the obvious that, oh, by the way, we also should be serious for the much tougher standard. To me, you know, we should not spend a lot of our time, you know, wasting in that regard. Now, I just wanted to bring to your attention some of our timelines that we're dealing with. As I talk to Kurt Carpereras, Richard Corey, I've often complained that I sometimes feel that that ARB sometimes does not pay enough attention to what we need in San Joaquin Valley. There is a lot of focus on South Coast's timelines, the ozone timelines. And they said, hey, here's your opportunity, get the board to to really see what you're dealing with. So I just want to, just by way of background, give you just a quick list of what are the standards that we're facing, what are the timelines. The one-hour ozone standard, that I think that is a great indicator of what might be achievable and what we really can do. If you recall, just a few short years ago, we were extreme non-attainment for the one-hour ozone standard. At that time, we thought it was impossible to meet the one-hour ozone standard. Earlier this year, EPA, after having four consecutive years of no violations, finally deemed the Valley to be in attainment. Thank you for all the help that you gave us. And we are the first region in the world that has gone from extreme non-attainment to actually reach attainment. And that's what gives us hope that, you know, maybe some of what looks impossible for PM, maybe I'll be here, or somebody else younger than me will be here in a few short years until you remember, say, I told you it's physically impossible. Look, we're there, we're in attainment. So we want to, you know, look with that optimistic perspective. We are on track to also meet the 1997 ozone standard, 84 parts per billion. That was another standard that we were extreme non-attainment. We had a black box. We could not identify how we get the reductions. Today, we have no black box. We are on track. If we stay the course with the mobile source reductions that ARB has in place, we will reach attainment before the 2023 deadline with no black box. We just submitted a plan that your board approved and sent to EPA that the 75 parts per billion standard, we're going to meet it on a timely fashion in 2031. So when it comes to ozone, there is a lot of progress that has been made. We are seeing clear improvement in ozone levels, and that's a good story there with respect to ozone. The 70 parts per billion, we're doing the modeling. EPA has not published the implementation rule, but we're going to need massive reductions for the 70 parts per billion. But some of the early indications by ARB is that once you reach 75 parts per billion, it's downhill, and it'll be a lot easier to get into the 70. So that's what we're hoping for. Now, the tough problem in San Joaquin Valley, and that's the part that I believe ARB maybe needs to pay a little bit more attention to, is our challenges with respect to PM2.5. I don't have to tell you, I wish Dr. Bombs was here. PM2.5, as you know, is a lot more dangerous to your health. We lose a lot of lives every year through premature deaths with PM2.5. Not as much with ozone, but PM2.5 is a much more severe problem, much more costly problem with respect to public health. We have a 1997 standard, a 24-hour standard of 65 micrograms per cubic meter. We were on the verge of meeting that standard in 2012 before the drought kicked in. Then we got huge numbers up and down the state. As you know, even Bay Area had non-attainment numbers, and a lot of other areas, we were not spurred from that. We had a little bit of a mishap with EPA, first approving an extension and then failing to act. So they retroactively gave us a deadline this year of December 2015 for meeting that standard. So unless we could put a time machine in our black box, there is no way to to meet that standard, but because, you know, at least with that timeline, 2015. Right now, we have to work with your staff and send EPA a 5% plan. I think we can do that. We have a couple of years, we're at 4.8%. reductions per year. I think we're going to be in attainment of that standard in 3-4 years at the most, but we need to be able to put together a 5% plan, and we're at 4.8%. The reason I mention that is you've heard us complain when, you know, there are rules perhaps for climate change that maybe add a little bit to our NOx inventory, and we say, hey, we're extreme non-attainment. We're serious non-attainment. We cannot afford any NOx increase. We're basically at 4.8%. Any small increase in emissions would kick us over that 5%. So we think we can put a 5% plan together and send it to EPA in a few short months. The 2006 standard, which is 35 micrograms per cubic meter, that requires almost as much reductions in emissions as does the standard that is before you today, the 2012 standard. The plan, the attainment deadline is 2019. And as you know, to show attainment, when they say deadline is 2019, you need 3 years of clean data. So 2019 really means 2017. So the plan is due 2017, and we have to be in attainment immediately because you need all of those reductions in 2017 to show attainment with a 35% plan. We're hoping to be able to put a plan together to do that. It's going to be very difficult at this point. Just look at the measures that you have in place already. The truck rule, the off-road rule, there will not be fully implemented until 2023. So to even without those measures being attainment in 2017 through 2019 may not be possible, but you know, we're going to give it a good shot and see what we can put together. And then the plan that's before you today, I already talked about that, you know, the attainment deadline is 2021. If you approve the action today and EPA ultimately approves it, then the deadline is extended to 2025, which really means 2023, 2024, 2025. You have to have 3 years of clean data, clean air to show attainment. Before I get into now, so that's all I have to say in terms of, you know, what how difficult the problem is. I want to talk a little bit now about what we're hoping to do. What is our ask of you? What we're going to do locally, and what we're hoping the federal government can do to reach attainment. Here's the charge just since 2000. And if you go back further, there's even greater reductions that have been made. As you can see, hundreds of tons of NOx have been reduced in San Joaquin Valley. The dotted line shows where we think we're going to be with respect to the regulatory measures that are in the hopper and will kick in that timeline. As you can see, we're still short about 150 tons or so from meeting the standard. And that last 150 plus ton is a lot harder to achieve than the first 600, 700, 800 tons of emissions where we had a lot of low-hanging fruit that we could get to. Now, we need transformative control measures. Despite major reductions in emissions, it's impossible to reach attainment without transformative measures. We not only need the technology, we need the infrastructure. We need to get to low emissions, no emissions, combustion devices, transportation technology to get to the standards that we need. But we need 90% reductions basically by 2025 to meet the latest PM2.5 standard. And as your staff said, most of those reductions have to come from mobile sources, which unfortunately we don't have regulatory authority over. The district has put together an indirect source review rule, the only air district in the state that has that. I was talking to my friends in South Coast. They're trying to see if they can do something similar to that in that region. We're doing what we can through incentive-based measures to indirectly reduce air pollution from mobile sources, but we need your help, EPA's help, to reduce mobile sources a lot further. Now, as we move forward, we need to leave no stone unturned at the local level, at the state level, at the federal level to reduce emissions from all sectors of our economy. And we also need incentive-based strategies to be able to get those reductions in a timely fashion. I just want to list some of the things that we're doing locally, and then I'll talk about the federal expectations that we have, and then I'll finish with what we're hoping to get from your board and from the state. At the district, we have our full commitment, my board's commitment, that we will leave no stone unturned in identifying every possible reductions in the stationary source emissions that we can get. And by that, I mean manufacturing, agriculture, all the sources that we have regulatory authority over. But unfortunately, as you saw, The total inventory is 15%. If we go crazy, we might be able to get another ton or two with some, you know, very draconian measures that we can put in place. But as you know, we need hundreds of tons of emissions, and one or two tons from stationary sources is not gonna get there. We're gonna do fully investigate opportunities to reduce directly emitted PM2.5 from all sources that we can think of: agriculture, fireplaces, incentive programs. But there is a lot of science that needs to be pursued in that area, both in terms of the inventory and in terms of the modeling. You know, you see it, maybe dust from almond harvesting. Is it really PM10? Is it PM35? You know, how soon does it settle? Is it really a big contributor to our PM2.5? There are a number of unanswered questions that we need to answer and then take action to reduce those emissions. Our board has already approved the Healthy Soil Initiative, where we will do our best to not only capture carbon, help with the climate change efforts that we support, but also improve productivity of the farmers by increasing the carbon content of the soil. We know it works for some crops and not for all others. There are some water quality issues as you bury some of that carbon back in the soil, and what does it do to water quality? So we have to look at it from all perspectives, but we're committed to work with our agricultural industry here to find every opportunity possible to promote healthy soil initiatives that will reduce emissions, reduce NOx emissions, reduce carbon emissions, and make farmers more productive. Conservation management practices, we have a very successful program where it acknowledges the variation that various farms and crops face in San Joaquin Valley and gives them opportunities to tailor control measures to reduce pollution most effectively from them. We have learned quite a bit from that process. We're going to engage our farmers and find any available opportunity to find conservation management practices that further reduce particulate matter, directly emitted particulate matter, but also something that the farmers can do effectively, cost-effectively, and with technological feasibility. As your staff mentioned, we have spent a lot of money, and we're trying to find a way to get a few more ounces of reductions in emissions from char broilers, the under-fired char broilers. And it's been very difficult, but you know, we're still working on that, but we're leaving no stone unturned. This measure, if we're very successful after spending millions of dollars, we will get perhaps 0.1 or 0.2 tons of PM reductions, but we're working on it. And then funding. In a minute, I will talk about what our funding hopes are at the state and federal level, but at the district, we will also explore any potential opportunities for securing funding at the local level. DMV funding, my board, the only air board in the air district, voted for extra DMV funds. And fortunately, those funds in the state law sunset in 2024, because when Senator Flores gave us the authority to impose those DMV dollars, at the time we were looking at a standard that with extreme ozone standard deadline was 2024. We thought that's it. But as you know, we got, you know, five new standards since then. So I'll be going to my board to ask for legislation or support for legislation to extend that authority. And hopefully we will get legislative support to continue bringing those resources. ISR not only reduces emissions by impacting the design of development, but also brings in funding. We have worked very hard with developers to even go beyond ISR and have them put mitigation measures. High-speed rail, for instance, we had concerns about the construction phase emissions. They've agreed to contribute $30 million to reduce pollution from construction phase of these measures. So these are just some of the measures that we're looking at, but we're continually looking at other opportunities and would welcome your help and your guidance on what more we can do. Federal government, as you heard, we have filed a petition to ask EPA to establish a national standard for heavy-duty engines. South Coast has done the same. Our petition goes a bit further. We ask also for controls on locomotives. They make up 10% of our air pollution in San Joaquin Valley. I know ARB is doing some inventory work. Maybe the impact is a little bit lower than previously estimated, but still, every ounce of NOx emissions counts. We are asking EPA to not only do new standards for new locomotives, but also for remanufactured locomotives and for in-use locomotives. And this is an area that even ARB says you don't have the full authority. We appreciate what you tried to do with the MOU with the railroads. We supported that. We still want to help whatever opportunities are there. But given that we have to address all pollution sources, we're hoping for your support on the locomotives. We had a call this morning with a few of the other stakeholders that have signed on with on these petitions. When it comes to locomotives, there is a bit of a fracture in the coalition. Some of the industry groups, for instance, CEB, they have indicated that since they have railroads as their members, they may not be supportive of the locomotive controls. So we really need your stature, your support for everything that we can do to also pressure EPA to do locomotive controls. And then funding. If you really care about public health, if you really want to get to cleaner as quickly as possible, you should be supportive of incentive-based control measures. Let's say we were extremely successful and tomorrow EPA says, oh great, we're going to do national standards for locomotives, for trucks, and we have it next month. And fortunately, waiting for the natural attrition to get to the reductions that we need will be way too late. These locomotives, these trucks last 20, 30, 40 years, as you know. So even if the regulation is there, which we think needs to be there to force people to take advantage of incentives, we need funding. South Coast has come forward with a funding plan. We had a board-to-board meeting, South Coast and San Joaquin, not too long ago. We're trying to work together to not only advocate for the funds that are needed, but also see how we can pool our resources. There are some of these trucks, locomotives that travel both regions. Can we work together, share our resources, and reduce pollution more effectively? And then finally, we need your help, and we need EPA to update their policies to allow for incentive-based reductions to be used. I think we have come a long ways, and without it, there is no way that we can put a provable SIP that gets us to the attainment. And then finally, just a list of demands or hopes and wishes from you that I will finish a couple of slides here. First, I have to tell you, as a local air pollution control officer, and sometimes when I talk to my colleagues, sometimes we get a little bit anxious, a little bit worried that is ARB still caring about the SIP needs and doing what it takes with respect to reducing criteria pollutants and toxic emissions. I heard Senator Flores a few months ago says, "Let's save lives in California and not before we save the world," or something to that effect. Now, I don't think those are two mutually exclusive objectives. We applaud you for taking leadership globally to reduce climate change impact and do what you can to get other nations and other states, even within the United States, to come on board. So we support all of those measures, but I think we have to do it in a way that also takes full advantage of the co-benefits that we talk about. It cannot just be a lip service that we will just get co-benefits or an afterthought. It has to be something that is really part of our ARB's strategy. One thing, and I have a couple of specific suggestions here. You saw your staff's presentation before this when we were talking about the NOx emissions from trucks. 2025 to 2021 timelines that we're looking at with respect to PM was not a big focus of that. We were looking at ozone emissions to past 2031. We're looking at some of the climate change goals in 2030, 2050. I have to tell you, last year when the legislature unfortunately was not able to pass those goals to reduce gasoline usage by 50%, as ambitious as that was, and at the end they were not able to do it. It fell way short of what we need and way too late, even if they were able to do it. 2050, 50% reduction in gasoline usage sounds like, oh my God, it's minuscule in terms of what we need and when we need it. So I'm hoping today, after you approve the bureaucratic part of this, to say, all right, let's send this plan and let's go to work on reducing air pollution. you also direct your staff and take a position to come back with a couple of new proposals. One is, let's re-examine the your mobile source strategy. I know it's been folded into the SIP strategy, but that mobile source strategy looks at 2031 and beyond. Let's take a close look at 2025. If at the end of the day you say, well, there's nothing possible, and that timeline, you know, I'm not going to say we can fully understand that, but you know, it would be something good to take to the public when we tell them the Valley now cannot meet the standards in 2025. We're going to be subject to devastating federal sanctions. We need to be able to make a showing that ARB, the district, EPA, we give it our full effort to get all the reductions that we can. But right now, 2025 was only a word on a slide when the item came before your board, and I complained about that. And here's my opportunity. I'm taking advantage of your advice, Richard and Kurt, to make sure your board fully appreciates the 2025 is a real timeline that you really need to look at and pay some attention to. Now, we've talked about super pollutants and short-lived pollutants. I think that provides the greatest opportunity for harmonizing criteria pollutant, toxic pollutant objectives with the climate change strategies. Of course, the real super pollutant, as you've heard from Dr. Sheriffs and Supervisor Mitchell or Board Member Mitchell, is for us in South Coast and San Joaquin, it's NOx. That's the super pollutant. So we want to make sure we don't lose the focus on reducing NOx. It should not be a struggle for us to convince people that in an area that is extreme non-attainment for ozone, serious non-attainment for PM, don't resort to oxidizing methane as a control measure for climate change. And oxidizing is a fancy term that people use, but we're talking about incinerating methane. Flaring methane, which generates NOx, generates PM. We should not do that. I know people have come to us, and I know the Aliso Canyon is a big problem, big disaster down there. We want to make sure we do things that so it doesn't happen. We want to mitigate its emissions, but let's be careful with not setting in place reactionary policies that have unintended consequences. We have been approached by some that say they want to come to the Valley to mitigate emissions, the methane emissions in response to Aliso Canyon, and they want to. They said the cheapest way, the easiest way to do it is come here and burn methane. That's not something that we would welcome. As you know, I've always asked you to bring dollars to the Valley, spend them here, but this is not the kind of investment that we need in San Joaquin Valley. Come in here and burn in methane, or write in a rule later on that forces the dairies to flare their methane is not. Is not good for us. Best way to deal with methane would be to capture it, send it back to pipelines that will reduce methane emissions. By making it a renewable fuel, will reduce black carbon. Black carbon is where we think you need to go, where we need to go to reduce emissions. Let's open the door to spending Prop 1B dollars on clean diesel engines right now. We're not able to do that. Let's force the 0.02 standard through incentives. We're getting some support for, on doing that. The ag burning, we definitely don't want to be in a position where we don't have options. Let's help us. And thank you, Senator Flores, for the meeting yesterday for setting us on track to find alternatives to avoid open burning. So I stop preaching there. I'll move on. And then one last comment. Don't go too far on relaxing the portable engine rule. Your staff is currently working on rolling back the portable engine rule, and we understand that. Some of the technologies that we had hoped for that would be available now or next year, they're not available. So we're not saying, maintain a rule that is impossible to comply, but we have been talking to your staff, we're moving in the right direction. I think we're gonna be able to come to your board and support that rule, but still needs a little bit more attention to the NOx needs. I think it should only allow the time that's needed for the technology to be to come about and then required as quickly as possible. I know your staff is trying to be responsive to the industry needs, and you know we're sensitive to that, but we cannot allow any more increases in or hold back reductions in emissions from that source category beyond what is needed to just for the technology to come about. So don't wait too long. Don't give them too much time to maintain those engines cleaner engines once those clean engines are available. Right now, we're not quite there. We're getting good response from your staff. I think they understand our concerns, and I'm hoping that we can get there. And then finally, funding is a big, as we've said, is essential. If you care about public health, there is no way to achieve the public health goals without funding. We ask you to continue to use the calenvirus screen to target funding in areas that have air quality issues and have a whole host of other problems. And I think this would, and also we don't object to Bay Area getting some funding to the extent that some of pollution from Bay Area impacts us. And if we can reduce those, or vice versa, yes. if we can help, so I'm not saying give, there's a lot that could be done in Sacramento, in Bay Area, because we do transport back and forth and we can help each other. So I'm not saying don't give money to Bay Area, but the focus should be disadvantaged communities, which unfortunately we have quite a few in areas that are non-attainment. Work with us. Hopefully you can do some advocacy at the federal level to and hopefully at the state level through education to bring about some additional funding. The cap and trade funding, even if it if all the original big estimations stand true, is not going to be enough. We need more dollars, more funding. ARB should get more funding for air quality as opposed to all these other agencies that right now some of the cap and trade funding goes, but let's also look at finding more sources. Technology advancement. We already have a big working group with EPA and yourself to advance technology, but that's really the key. And then finally, recognize the Valley's need for near zero emissions because of the timeline that we're talking about, the geography of having to be able to have a truck climb Grapevine and go 200 miles. It may not be doable in the timeline that we're talking about with electric vehicles, electric trucks. So near zero emissions, natural gas in particular, we want a little bit more openness to using natural gas. We think it can be a great bridge to renewable natural gas. And with that, I thank you for the time that you gave me. And if you have any questions or comments, I'll be here. Thank you.
I'm sure we will want to talk to you further, but I think we should probably move on at this point. That was quite a tour de force, actually.
Yes.
You covered a lot of ground, and I think it's easy to get confused by the layered requirements and deadlines of the Clean Air Act and the plans that are overlapping each other and filed on top of other plans. I'm suffering from a little bit of deja vu personally because I was appointed to my current position, as most of you know, by Governor Schwarzenegger after my predecessor, Bob Sawyer, was summarily fired. And the issue had to do with this district and the question of whether they were going to be bumped up to a higher level in order to give them more time to achieve the ozone standard. But it also had to do with the very strong, it was really based on the very strong objections by the environmental and environmental justice communities in this region to what they felt was inadequate amount of activity that was going on in the district. That is, they felt the rules were not sufficient and that the district wasn't doing everything that it could at that point. A lot has happened since then, and much of it is very good. But we find ourselves still in a position where we're concerned that the plans that exist need improving. And this is not just, I'm not pointing fingers here. I'm just saying we're not, we don't have everything we need at the moment. And so I want to get us to focus on the fact that what's before us today is a recommendation that we send a plan forward to EPA that our staff concedes is not an adequate plan, and then work to make it better and, in the future. And I guess I'd like to know, before we turn to the witnesses here, whether there's any realistic alternative to that approach that you've given us that could perhaps get us further faster.
Yes, Chair, and just for the record, I don't recall advising Syed, but but to your point, and it's right on point, staff has presented a procedural approach, process called for or allowed for under the Clean Air Act, really, which is consistent with historical practice. But directly to your point, are there other options? And there's at least one, and I'm going to ask Kirk Kaparos to lay out that, because I think it'll be useful going through, just as you noted, the follow-on testimony.
So, Chair Nichols, as you noted, staff covered in their presentation, the SIP in front of you today does meet the minimum requirements of the Clean Air Act. As the first step in the stepwise process, the requirements for this SIP are, however, admittedly lower than what they would be for a full-on attainment SIP. A full attainment SIP requires a detailed demonstration that the control strategy in place will provide all of the emission reductions needed for attainment. And that's not the goal of this thing. It's, as you sort of alluded to, Chair Nichols, it's unsatisfying. It doesn't get you to attainment. Even though the staff has concluded that this plan does meet the minimum requirements of the Act, we do believe you have options within the broader context of the planning requirements of the Act, should you choose to go down a different path. You could direct staff to conduct additional public review and exploration of programs and regulations to further reduce emissions toward attainment, particularly with an eye toward what will be needed to attain. The review, the standard for the SIP in front of you is whether or not it has reasonable available control measures. And to be perfectly frank, reasonable available control measures in the San Joaquin Valley is not sufficient. Mr. Syed referred to best available control measures. To be perfectly frank, an attainment SIP for this region will actually have to push the standard of best available control measures. So you could direct us to go back and spend some time looking at just how far we need to go with the sort of controls and emission reductions needed for the region. If such an effort would include ARB staff holding public meetings here in the region. We would be working obviously very closely with the district staff, but meeting with all Valley stakeholders, the public, the agriculture, and other critical stakeholders here in the Valley. I think as part of that, one of the things we would want to focus on is not just the measures, but the science and emission inventory that underlie the SIP. That would allow the discussion here in the Valley to be thinking about what these measures need to look like in the context of attainment, not just in the context of what are the minimum requirements needed for this current first step in the PM planning. If you were to take a path like that, we would recommend that you direct us to come back to you in some relatively short amount of time, perhaps 3 to 4 months. With findings out of that effort and recommendations for how you could proceed at that point. Lastly, is sort of a housekeeping item, I would say. The moderate SIP is due this month. So if we were to take a path like this, we would reach out to USEPA so that they were clear and understood what the process was that we were going through here, that it was focused on attainment. We believe with that sort of communication between ourselves and them, they would have the discretion to not immediately have to take any action in terms of the state hasn't taken the action that's on its plate. Yes, you do have an option. You do have options in terms of how you want to handle the plan today, even though it does meet the very minimum requirements of the Act.
Well, I'm not speaking for the board because the board hasn't had this discussion, but I thought it was important before we heard from the witnesses who are here to have a sense of what might be possible. So with that.
Could I just ask one clarifying question? So in having the moderate SIP due this month, and we're looking at serious attainment designation, then how do those two intersect?
In our communications with the plan that staff alluded to, that we're going to develop in an accelerated process with the district over the next 12 months, would be focused at the serious area attainment deadline. And we would communicate with EPA that that was the intent. That's how we thought this, the region would be going. And that a request for the serious attainment deadline would come later, but in a timely fashion.
But then as part of the process, we still do turn in a moderate SIP is part of the process.
EPA will look at its checklist, and even if we were to turn a serious area plan in September of next year, they would ask, have you turned in your moderate area plan too? And so they would have to review that, determine, yes, it's impracticable to attain by 2021. We now reclassify you to serious. They move that plan to the side of their desk. They would already have a serious area plan. They would then put that in the middle of their desk and start that review.
Okay, and I don't want to delay our lunch, but then my understanding is that US EPA did reject some portion of a plan. Where are we in that, in this layering?
So for one of the other standards that we were talking about, the region was pursuing what's called a most stringent measures plan. And that is one of the allowed paths within the Act to gain additional time to further reduce emissions. EPA, we worked very, very closely with EPA. And unfortunately, at the very end, they concluded that for a couple of measures that we had not provided all of the documentation that they would need to be able to conclude whether or not the region had most stringent measures. They did not determine the negative, that they weren't most stringent measures, but they didn't have the information in front of them to make the positive conclusion.
And where are we?
That then
are
takes us in.
Are we providing more information?
That action by EPA takes us into the 5% emission reduction plan that Mr. Syed referred
just
to.
I
believe it. And
perhaps this is why you want 3 to 4 more months to explain this.
So it's okay, but that was very helpful to me. Thank you very much. Yeah.
Thank you for asking.
Okay. We do have 9 people. Actually, Syed is not a witness. He's the head of the district, so we don't count him. So we have 8 more people, however, who wish to testify and have 3 minutes apiece. I think we should hear from them. So we'll begin with Genevieve Gale.
Hello, board members. Thank you all for coming down to Fresno. I really appreciate it. My name is Genevieve Gale. I'm here on behalf of Young Fresnans for the Environment and also the Central Valley Air Quality Coalition. I really appreciate the discussion that just happened. It warms my heart, truly, to hear that there are options available to us. If we really want to extend this deadline, as we've all agreed will be necessary to put together a really good plan, we need to make sure that this moderate attainment SIP is legally defensible and will be approved by the EPA. And unfortunately, at present, there are 3 reasons for why it won't be approved by the EPA and why we need more time to include those in there. The first is that this plan does not include all reasonable available control measures. The EPA sent back the 2015 plan for the 1997 PM standard for failure to include the most stringent measures. EPA suggested measures they could include. The environmental justice community has suggested measures to include. They haven't been included. This 2016 plan does not include any new additional information, so it will be denied like the last one was. The second reason is that this plan does not include any contingency measures. ARB states that the plan can meet contingency measure requirements based on emission reductions that could go beyond those needed for the reasonable further progress demonstration. However, the EPA has clearly stated that, quote, crediting an area for excess emission reductions to satisfy the contingency measure requirement is not allowable for moderate areas that cannot attain the statutory attainment date, end quote. And there's a history of not including contingency measures and thus getting disapproved by the EPA. The same 2015 plan was sent back for failure to include contingency measures. In 2011, EPA approved all elements of the 2008 PM plan, except for the contingency measures, which they have disapproved. In 2009, the EPA disapproved the 2004 ozone plan because it did not meet the clean air requirements for contingency measures. In 2002, the EPA issued a finding of failure to submit contingency measures. So we don't have any in here, and if we don't put them in the next couple months, the plan will be denied and we won't get that extension that we so need. The third reason that this won't pass is there was a lack of a public process. There was not one public workshop on this plan held in Fresno. And I know I'm well aware of ARB's process and really appreciate all of the workshops that you host, and you come all across the state to host them. And unfortunately, there wasn't one on this plan. There was only updates given at board meetings. So there was, we haven't seen the modeling, we haven't seen the measures. And Dolores will talk more about that. So the board has decision whether to pass this plan or not. And I believe we should take some time and put in the measures so that it can be approved by the EPA. Thank you.
Okay, Kevin Hamilton.
Good morning, Madam Chair, members of the board. Thank you all for being here today. My name is Kevin Hamilton. I'm the Executive Director of Central California Asthma Collaborative, and I serve as a San Joaquin Valley member of your Environmental Justice Committee working on the Greenhouse Gas Scoping Plan, and I thank you for the opportunity to do that work. And I want to assure Mr. Sederden that the EJAC is very concerned about the issue of reducing greenhouse gas, not further exacerbating the criteria pollutant issues here in the valley. And I really feel assured that the board feels the same way about this and will work in that direction. I want to agree with the comments made earlier by Kurt and Richard. I really felt strongly that this process was not vetted through the normal public process we would take a plan of this magnitude through. Myself, who I consider myself very aware of what's going on, did not get a chance to actually look at the modeling here until just a few weeks ago. I had some questions about that. Happily, Dr. Magliano has been really good about answering some of those, but that wasn't a public process. That wasn't an area where everybody got to talk about that. And then I look at EPA's rejection of the 2015 PM plan and their take on this idea of NOx limitation within the valley, and they don't seem to agree with that. Their documentation, in fact, seems to go the other direction, or for some other reason, they're calling out additional ammonia controls, feeling that, and VOCs, and secondary VOCs. And we, again, we would like to see a workshop where ARB science staff and EPA staff are in the same room, and they hash this out, and we get an idea of again, what the unified idea is going forward, and then we don't see the plan go forward with, I won't call it defective modeling, but modeling that the approving agency does not agree with, and will likely, in fact, I could predict with certitude, send back to us again with a refusal. And again, as Genevieve pointed out here, we have a long history of this, of plans going to EPA, being turned around and sent back. And we really can't afford that kind of delay, because we talk about a short delay here, maybe 3 to 4 months to go through this public process. But when we talk about the EPA rejecting plans, we're talking about years of delay happening. So let's get it right the first time. And so this is not a typical, the environmentalists aren't going for another delay for the sake of delay. It was great. I agreed with almost everything Mr. Sederden said today after his opening remarks. And I think there's been some great work done here, as a matter of fact, and we have great work lying before us. So we need the tools to do that. They should be contained within these plans, and right now they don't. So thank you very much for your time today.
Thank you, Chair Nichols and the Super Board. My name is Janet Dietz-Kamay, and to me, this issue is urgency. I have a label. I am an asthmatic. And I'm speaking for those of us whose population grows daily in this valley. I realized I was asthmatic one day when I went out to walk my dog. I knew the air was bad. I put on a mask. During the walk, I almost passed out on the sidewalk. I was very fortunate. I managed to get home. My second evidence of being asthmatic, and these are before I was diagnosed, was I reacted to smoke in the air. I developed acute bronchitis going into pneumonia. It took quite a while for me to get over that. Now I start my day by going to Valley Air, Real Air Quality Advisory Network, and see what the particulate level is at the time before I even step outside of the house. If I want to walk my dog, I have to see that the particulate level is below 15. If I go out above 15, I wear a mask. I can't go out at all when it goes above 30. Just now, as this presentation was being made, particulate level in my area was 27 microunits. That happens frequently, and it will become more frequent during the winter months. I am an outdoor person. I spend a lot of my time in the house. I like to ride my bike. I like to go 15 miles. Rarely I can. Since the rain, I have been able to go out a few days to ride my bike. During the winter, when everybody's going to be using their fireplaces, I won't be out much at all. The smoke particulates are lethal to me. If I don't take care of myself, if I don't go to the RON and check the particulate levels, I will end up in the emergency room as I was with the bronchitis, or worse. This asthma is a very serious condition. You can die with asthma. This valley needs to clean up its air. All of us are being affected by this. Maybe we're not all asthmatic, but we are all breathing this air, and our health is being jeopardized by it. Thank you.
Good morning, Chair Nichols, board members. My name is Dr. Janelle Lee. I am an emergency medicine resident physician at UCSF Fresno. I work at Community Regional Medical Center in downtown Fresno. I'm here today to speak on behalf of patients and to voice my concerns about the air pollution here in the valley. As you know, particulate matter has serious effects on both respiratory and cardiovascular health. I've lived here now about a year and have met countless patients who have suffered from the poor air quality here. Today, I'd like to share just a couple patient stories with you. I've changed their names for anonymity's sake. I met Jack. He's an 8-year-old boy. He happens to have asthma. He has to take expensive controller medications just to keep his asthma symptoms at bay. I met Jack one day in the ER. Happened to be a poor air quality day. He was playing soccer and nearly passed out from a severe asthmatic attack. His mom, a single parent, had to leave work, pick him up from school, rush him to the ER so that he can get life-saving breathing treatments. Unfortunately for Jack, mom decided to pull him out from soccer because the air quality was so bad and she couldn't risk him dying on the soccer field. The second patient I'd like to talk to you about, her name's Sarah. She and her husband moved to the valley about a year ago. Unfortunately for her, she used to have childhood asthma, never had symptoms afterwards, but her asthma flared up once she moved to Fresno. It was so severe, she had to quit her job, go on medical leave indefinitely. Her lungs, unfortunately, had reactive scarring from the air quality here.
and had to be placed on supplemental oxygen at all times. After speaking with Sarah, she said that while she loved her new life in the valley, her husband loved her new job. Her pulmonologist told her, you need to move out of Fresno, get out of the valley, move back to the Bay Area to save your life. She said, the air is literally suffocating me to death. I share these stories with you today to remember that the decisions we make here today have lifelong impacts on the people here in the valley. And we all need better air. Better air means better health, fewer hospital visits, fewer visits seeing me, and more soccer practice, more hardworking individuals who choose to stay in the valley and want to stay in the valley. So I urge the board today to really think about and reconsider approving this plan before the right contingency measures are in place. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon, Chair Nichols, board members. My name is Dolores Weller, and I am the director for the Central Valley Air Quality Coalition. We're based here in Fresno, and we are a partnership of organizations throughout the San Joaquin Valley that work on air quality policy. And you will find me here at this Air District office very often. I'd like to talk a little bit about the public process or lack thereof on this particular item. As Syed opened up his remarks, he mentioned there was a robust public process, and I disagree with that. This plan, from the beginning, has been described as we're not going to meet this standard. There is almost it's useless to get into the details of it. That's the tone of the planning process for this plan. The modeling became available from ARB late July. The Air District provided an update to the Air Board members in August. And in September, the plan was adopted. And it was essentially a plan to not do anything. We have made recommendations in the past on previous plans, as other speakers have commented, that this is a little bit of deja vu, agreeing with Chair Nichols. I recall in 2013 in Bakersfield, when ARB was approving the PM plan there, countless people spoke about their personal experiences living here in the San Joaquin Valley and also asked for that plan to be rejected. And as other speakers have mentioned, that plan has been rejected by EPA. And EPA has given clear recommendations on what the district can do further. We are pleased that the district has taken a different approach with ozone. The Central Valley Air Quality Coalition proposed a work group made up of the environmental justice community, industry, and along with EPA, ARB, and the district representatives. And together we worked on the 2008 ozone plan. And we were hoping that the district was going to follow through and keep with that process with the PM plan. Because during that planning process, we all agreed that the real work where we were really going to roll up our sleeves was with PM. And so we're really looking forward to that process for this plan. And we ask that you hold off on approving this plan and direct the staff to conduct a public process over 90 days to really be able to look at the modeling and what further controls can be included. Thank you.
I love this podium. See how high it goes. All right.
You're just showing off.
It's just so great to be here in Fresno and have a podium that goes up. Bill McGavin with the Coalition for Clean Air. Thank you for the opportunity to make some comments. As the testimony from Janet and Janelle reminded us, we're here today to talk about particulate matter. And the reason why we're here to talk about particulate matter is that it is making so many people sick. And this board has done a lot over the years to reduce PM. We know that PM causes lung disease, heart disease, It causes illness and premature death. And in fact, it seems like every year there are more and more studies showing us that particulate matter is even more hazardous to our health than previously thought. So it seems like we really need to throw everything that we have at this problem. And that's why I urge you to exercise the option that Mr. Carperos outlined. And I really thank you, Chair Nichols, for eliciting that at the beginning of this discussion, because I think it really helps to frame it. So we heard both from ARB staff and from the district about a number of measures that are in development. And we support all of those. Glad to hear that there's a biomass plan in a preliminary stage. We support renewable natural gas. Think that could be very beneficial for the valley. And we certainly agree that we all need to roll up our sleeves and try to think of feasible ways to raise the enormous amounts of incentive dollars that will be necessary to turn over the fleets rapidly enough to help both South Coast and San Joaquin Valley come into attainment. But all of that said, I think there is more that can be done. And we've outlined in our letter 8 possible measures, including reductions in flaring, controls on agricultural equipment, limits on open burning, which Senator Flores has been a leader on for many years. And so I think the choice you have now is whether to go forward as quickly as possible to exercise all those available options, which is the way that I understand the option that Mr. Carperos outlined, or to say, no, we're going to wait on that, we're going to put it off and say, you know, right now it's just too hard, and put it off some years into the future. So we would urge you to move as quickly as you can and put everything we have into solving this problem for the people here in the San Joaquin Valley. Thank you.
Good afternoon. Thank you very much, Manuel Cunha, President EC Farmers League, also a member of the USDA task force that was set up in way back with Jan Sharpless. Kurt and Richard, Karen, Lynn Terry, and I can name a host. Agriculture has been there to do the research in 93. Took out of EPA's HIDE, Region 9, 300,000 to start the first under Jan Sharpless to deal with the air quality of PM. If we think, as people said, maybe this plan didn't go through the full process, but I remember June 30th of 2016 or 29th, I get a call from Kerry Drake. We've denied your plan, so tomorrow you got until December of 2015, I think, to re- But EPA has held on to the plans for years of comments. It's only the San Joaquin Valley. No other air district gets, except for the South Coast. And I remember being electrocuted by Barry Wallerstein when he invited me into his office for with coffee. So this time we didn't go down there. I let the district go. But the problem is that Mr. Flores was down here. I didn't even know you were doing a biomass. I didn't even know the almond board was involved. And yet we set the first research and spent $3.5 million before you ever became involved. If that's the process, then the environmentalist, then I've got a complaint. We didn't have fair process even this week to sit down and talk about biomasses. Because your water board, or the state water board, Madam Chair, is going after agriculture for all the nitrates. You have compost regulations by the state water board. Conflict with this. You talked about a truck length rule, you know, modernization, phase two. I do know that the CHP cited a bunch of my farmers because the truck was too long, because the tractor, they put the new configuration in, made the trailer a little longer. So we got a citation because the trailer's too long with the tractor. And Kurt, we spoke about that. So if we're going to go forward, and I understand the processes, I don't want a repeat of 700 series. Because the agriculture industry, and Madam Chair, if you could indulge a second, please. The ag industry has been a great supporter of research. We spent a lot of money together, Edwards Air Force Base. And Madam Chair, I remember you with Carol Browner, and you were a great vice administrator of the EPA at that time. And we've always held our word that we will do the research, but don't do research that says that my farmers can't milk their cows because today's a bad day. No farm days, no drive days because of the air, because that's going to be the solution. I would hope, Madam Chair, that you would ask the staff, and I know that Richard and other folks, and especially Karen, if we're going to look at research, let's do it right. Let's do it. We don't hurt the jobs. Dr. Tellis, if you remember, said the worst thing is not air quality. It's when a person loses their job and they don't have a job. So I want to thank you. Madam Chair, I would ask that if some of the board members would like to be on a tour of our valley and this state, that even our own board members of this valley include some of the folks that have been here for a long time, that have helped raise $70 million plus. And incentives are important, and we will do everything to help you get those monies, and we will do that.
Thank you.
Thank you for allowing me the extra few minutes, and
well,
if Kevin
it.
Would like you, some of those time
a lot
minutes.
Of progress has been made. A lot
thank
has
you very much.
And you've been thank part you, of Mr. it, Good. So thank you. Mr. Isom.
Good afternoon. My name is Roger Isom. I'm President and CEO of the Western Agricultural Processors Association and the California Cotton Ginners and Growers Association. And at this point, you know, our goal today was to support the plan as written. We can go back and forth. EPA is not here to defend themselves, but I can tell you, I can assure you that the Air District continues to come at us with every possible rule and regulation. They've never let us off the hook, and I can assure you we're the most regulated ag industry across the country without a doubt. But let me tell you what I do want to say, and that is that this incentives are definitely a critical piece of this. We want to commit to work with you as we did with Aramula's bill. We were at the forefront of that in getting that additional dollars. The result of that is, and it was really timely because NRCS, USDA NRCS, did a press release during the middle of this meeting touting the ag emission reductions from the tractor incentive program that, as you recall, back in 2008 when ARB adopted the SIP that required ag tractor reductions to get 5 to 10 tons reductions beginning in January 2014 to have that done by January 1 of 2017. In that press release, and I'm sure the district can verify this, we already have 12.49 tons of reductions of NOx on a voluntary basis as a result of those incentive programs. They work. You don't have us up here bitching and moaning about it. They're done. They're already in place. We need to continue that. Whether it's Carl Moyer, working with Board Member Berg, working on the Farm Bill, working on DERA, as we've been back to D.C. to push for more funds there. We use all of those programs. And the thing to remember, too, though, is that the farmers have put in our share. More than 50% of that money came from the farming community to do that. So I just want to say that we are here to commit to work with that and to continue that effort on that, as well as the research that Mr. Cunha brought up. The last thing is, I know I've just got a minute, is on the biomass and biogas. We were unaware of this summit, but let me tell you something. I'm not sure that there's anybody else out there that knows as much as we do about the biogas industry and what we're doing, because we're not just talking about it. Our organization has a project in Woodland. It's a commercial scale research project. It's a syngas, synthetic gas, biogas plant. And for the last 2 years, we've run every kind of agricultural byproduct through it that we can, from rice straw to cotton stalks to almond shell, walnut shell, almond hulls, you name it. We've tried it to prove that the technology works, B, that it's cost effective, and C, and most importantly for the air district, that it's going to meet the NOx emissions on the other end. And so we've tried different engines, catalysts. We've proven the technology. Where we're at today is that we've got a walnut operation in the valley that's actually doing an interconnect study with PG&E, that we are moving ahead. In fact, we met with the Air District 2 weeks ago on the permitting process to start going down that road. So it's not just talking about it. We also have an almond operation up in Sacramento Valley looking at the same type of thing. So we're moving forward with that, trying to get you the answers that you need, and we've been heavily involved in that. Thank you.
Thank you. Our last witness. Yes, Sarah. Okay.
Good afternoon, Chair Nichols. Good to see everybody. I'm happy to have you here in Fresno. I'm Sarah Sharp. I currently work with Central California Asthma Collaborative, and I've been a part of this air quality advocacy movement since 2005, and I also am feeling some deja vu. And I've worked closely with many of you on the board, and some of you are new. And it's good to see the new faces. Really want to welcome you to Fresno. We would like you to come more often. As you can see, you just got a really good sampling of the wide range of issues that we're dealing with here and the severity of the problem and why we continue to have to bring these issues up at your board and all the other boards that we can. We know everybody's doing the best that they can, and you know, we have in the past found, with many of the examples given by my colleagues, that when we go back and revisit a plan, we often do come out with a better plan. And that's what we're asking for today, a little bit more time to make sure we get the best outcome possible for my children who still play soccer and don't have asthma. I myself have asthma, and we've had some really bad days lately. Also want to mention that we've been asking for many years for the ag equipment rule to happen. Roger just reminded me, I think it was Roger or Manuel, that, you know, we've been asking the ARB to really make progress on the ag equipment rule, and that's one of the last sources of diesel that we haven't addressed as a state, and I know it's difficult. We all know that our jobs are important, and nobody wants anybody to go without a job or without a healthy life, you know, or there's just, we don't see the need to choose between the two, and it shouldn't be that way anywhere in California. So in closing, I think just on behalf of all the people that I work with and have worked with, and I serve on the Air District's Citizens Advisory Committee and have served on many boards, but we would really ask you to grant the district a 90-day period to correct the deficiencies that have been mentioned previously, and kind of go along with what Kurt mentioned as the other option. We just feel like there's a little bit more work to be done. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. That concludes our list of witnesses, and so we will close the record for official purposes at the moment, but we will have now some time for board discussion, and I'm happy to recognize any of my fellow board members who might have a suggestion as to what they'd like to see us do next, starting with Senator Flores.
Thank you. Very much appreciate it. First, thank you to the chair and to staff for clarifying at the beginning the options. So I think that, you know, obviously helps a lot listening to the testimony. Second, I would say that I would definitely like to have the 90 days just from the input point of view. This was, in some sense, you know, kind of put on us. The EPA gave us a very short time. We created a model in July, and we sent it to the district. District had a month, September 15th, voted on it, and we find ourselves here the next month. So I just think in that process, you know, giving our environmental justice folks a little more time to have some concrete and some very good conversations with this district. And I would say, just for the record, that, you know, it'd be really not a good thing to spend 90 days and have nothing come out of it.
Yes.
So, and that's more of a challenge to both the EGA community and to the district, to try to figure out how much more we can eke out of this. Even, I think, as Syed said, there's so many more larger things to solve. It would seem that as we work towards this, that we should hold. Allow those 90 days, and I'm not sure how to frame that, Madam Chair, in terms of a motion, so I will leave that to staff to figure out the right way to do this, because I heard very clear that we also have to contact EPA and let them know exactly what our thought processes are and when they are likely to see something, because we are going from a moderate plan to an extreme plan. And I was very happy to hear, and I always thought the process worked that way, the checkoff list, but everything still has to be on the desk. So the moderate plan has to be completed. At the same time, they have to very seamlessly go on to the more extreme plan, which I think would be of value to have these 90 days to make sure that at least is inclusive of what the environmental justice groups are asking for. And I will say, just to Mr. Cunha and to Roger Isom, who I both worked with for many years, on the biomass conversation we had yesterday, Mr. Corey was there, thank you for being there, and staff who were there, let's reset that as well to make sure we have those groups, as we are doing today, you know, have a more inclusive conversation. So I think in some sense, opening up both processes would be a good thing as we move forward. So I would just say we did have a lot of good conversation, but I don't think we necessarily set anything in stone. So I think in both senses, opening those up would be a great thing. That's my only comment.
That's excellent. I'd like to call on Mr. Serna, and then I understand that Mr. Satterton would like to come back up and have a few words.
Thank you, Chair. First of all, I want to thank the folks that testified this afternoon. I find your testimony very compelling. And anytime I hear about accounts of public processes not materializing the way that constituents had hoped, and it's very consistent testimony about that, my antennae tend to go up, and that goes for all the various hats that I wear, and I know some of my other elected colleagues up here also understand. And so I'm definitely, first of all, prepared to support a motion, if it comes from Senator Flores or others, that would include at least 90 days to explore some of the options that Kurt mentioned in his remarks. And you know, I just want to stress, it kind of goes without saying, but I'll say it anyways, this is just too important not to exhaust a healthy conversation, no pun intended, between the constituency that is really focused on public health, and I'm glad we had some folks come all the way down from Sacramento to be here as well, and a local district that has, you know, obviously a very, very a tough challenge in front of them. So we have to get this right. We have to, I think, at the end of the process, look back with some sense of pride, knowing that we didn't shortchange ourselves, we didn't shortchange the public. So I'll be prepared to second a motion should one of my colleagues decide to make it and frame it that way.
Just to be clear, I want to make sure that we heard correctly, that I heard correctly, the staff's view that there are ways in which this plan can be strengthened, mm-hmm. not just rolled over into the next plan, because obviously there is going to have to be a much more ambitious plan in about a year. So, you know, you don't want to, in effect, waste time. But at the same time, people here are anxious to see progress, and that includes, I assume, some specific things that they would like to have added to the current process.
And Mr. Corey, could you also address the time frame? Do we have the time frame to be able to look at this today, the additional 90 days?
We do, in that the follow-up that Mr. Kopera said we need to do with EPA, we will lay that out. But the process that you laid out, and we will lay this out to EPA as well, but just to be crystal clear and go to the chair's question, what I'm hearing is direction, one, not to act on the staff proposal, to direct staff to hold in the region a public process, and in my mind, that probably translates, I think that translates into more than one workshop. I think it translates into a series of work group discussions, and they're focused on really, the central focus is additional opportunities for NOx reductions and PM from mobile and stationary sources. And this would require a not only a close work with the range of stakeholders, but with the district. And to return back to the board, and I'm going to say February because the process that I'm talking about is there's holidays, and there's also it's more than one workshop because the process is going to be a really important element of this. And a report back to the board in February to the point that was raised. You want action to come out of this. Is what is the discovery that came out of that process? Where are there additional opportunities for NOx and direct PM from mobile and stationary? And to the chair's point, how many of those live in the moderate plan versus the serious comprehensive PM plan that will return to the board later in 2017? So I think it's a report on what was the result of that discovery, and what is the recommendation, specific actions with respect to the moderate plan, and what may live there versus the more comprehensive plan that will on PM that returns to the board in fall.
Mr. Joy had his hand.
I think Mr. Corey answered my question. I think the motion was intended not just about the public review, but direction to explore, as you put it earlier, additional programs and regulations to further reduce emissions toward attainment. And you gave some examples. I just was clarifying
that. If I can just put, Chair Nichols, if I can just put a finer point on both what my colleague, Supervisor Joya, and what Mr. Corey just mentioned. I don't want us to forget, I think it was the last thing that Kurt mentioned, which is if we're going to really look at aggressively tackling NOx, it's going to require looking at this SIP actually being the pressure that raises the bar. In other words, it's going to have to involve some innovative thinking, and that has to be part of what's going to happen in the next 3 to 4 months, I would imagine. Mm-hmm.
That's correct, but and not to confuse us, but I think it hopefully, if I say this correct, it will help clarify. And that is currently the agency has out for public review a mobile source SIP strategy. And I would characterize it, and I think I did some fact checking here.
That term's overused right now.
That it's the most comprehensive, ambitious mobile source NOx package that we've ever put together. This is a package that will be coming to the board as part of the mobile source attainment strategy next year, early next year. So that maps directly into this conversation. So if the conversation is, are we missing opportunities? And the discussion down in the valley is going to be both about NOx, again, on mobile and stationary, as well as direct PM mobile and stationary.
So I have both Ms. Mitchell and Mrs. Reardon will hear from both of them. I think what, you know, we understand that legally your initial approach, which was to say, yeah, this meets the standards for a moderate plan, so let's just turn it in and get on with it, was probably legally defensible, although I've heard some statements that might make one wonder whether that was really true or not. But even assuming that it was, that just doesn't seem like the process that we would like to see followed, given the severity of the problem. But go ahead. We've got other board members from other districts here who have...
Thank you. Thank you, Madam Chair. And one thing I think that we cannot emphasize too much is that when we are talking about turnover of heavy-duty trucks, really the only way that we're going to get there is that combination of incentives plus regulation. And as part of our petition to the US EPA on our low NOx regulation, we also ask the federal government to think about developing a superfund for air. You have superfunds for, you know, soil contamination and other kinds of contamination and water even, but we don't have anything for air. And I think this is an effort that we really ought to be pursuing as well when we talk about low NOx and the challenges that we face here. We need to not impact agriculture and business to such a degree that we're losing jobs. We can't do that in this economy. We need to be very cognizant of keeping a vibrant economy. And there's no reason why we can't do both. but I think a dedicated fund that keeps coming into a super sort of a super fund for clean air is one way we can do that. And we need a broad coalition. It can't just be San Joaquin Valley District and the South Coast District. We need all of California, all of our districts to help with this. We need the coalition of the northeastern states. We really need to be working on this in a very broad way. So I just want to say that because I know that Dr. Sheriffs and I and the San Joaquin District and my district have worked together and are talking right now about how are we going to get the incentive funding for these plans that we are now working on. So that is a really important part of that.
Mm-hmm. Mrs. Reardon.
Yes. In thinking about groups that are affected and contributing to some of the pollution here, not heard a lot of talk about not only local government, but state government. And I thought of this yesterday as I was driving up, saw quite a bit of dust and thought, oh, well, somebody's out plowing the field. It wasn't. It was Caltrans. And, you know, none of us want the, you know, problems with the ultimate problem of not having our roads plowed because we tend to get the tumbleweed problem. And if anybody's ever hit a tumbleweed, you don't want to hit a tumbleweed again. So I understand what the focus should be. But I also remember, and maybe you've taken care of this, not only do they plow, but they burn at times those tumbleweed piles that they put together. So I really think that there are government agencies that should be involved. I mean, it sounds like a small thing, but in the aggregate, we may be contributing quite a bit as we operate our government. So I would encourage you to include them in the process of what we might do more to help this air pollution control district.
Ms. Tagvarian?
Thank you. I just wanted to thank CARB staff and the district staff and all of the public members who've been here today. Really appreciate it, and I would support the motion. I'm hoping that in this next period of time, and I want to say that I appreciate that you're, Richard, that you're actually looking at how long it's going to take. And I think even that's an abbreviated time period, but it's really important to think about more than one workshop, to think about a work group that can kind of dig in and, you know, meet for a long period of time. So I really appreciate that. I think one of the things that I've heard is that there are specific milestones, and I know that stated in here there are quantitative milestones, but one of the things I think is really important is for us to see that what are we projecting as those milestones that can then accompany both the regulations and the incentives, because I think that those things all need to go together, and without those, I don't know that we'll have robust support for the incentives. I really like the transformative climate communities, and I would like to see what the actual PM2.5 reductions would be, because while I think that's a really important project and one that, you know, we supported going forward in the legislature, it would be important to look at the fact that it doesn't seem like that's where the major sources are for PM2.5. It'll be a benefit, but where are there other transformative measures, perhaps to Judy's point, of where else can we get that kind of major infusion so that we can transform in the ag industry, for instance, to really help. So I hope that we can look at the project that way going forward, and I'm sure that everyone will really put their best foots forward and put a lot of time into this in the next 3 to 4 months. Thank you.
Syed, I know you've been anxious to speak. I had to give everybody a chance to get their views in.
I really want to thank you and thank your staff for the direction that this discussion is going. What you're suggesting to do here is really what we wanted to do from the beginning. We didn't think, the reason I, you know, criticize this process for being just bureaucratic, to show, oh yeah, let's prove the obvious and meet the bare minimum requirements. If that's all we're doing, I was not in favor of delaying that. But I'm glad that Richard is not mad at me, and Kurt is not mad at me, and we're going in the right direction. Let's take more time. That's what we wanted to do, because you know, when EPA failed to act, by the way, they did not disapprove our plan. They just failed to act by deadline. What had happened, it only gave ARB the district time. We met in Region 9. I said, let's not send a plan. Let's wait. Let's wait. And Region 9 and others, they said, no, we don't want to miss the deadline. Let's do a plan, put a plan together quickly and send it through. So that's what you had. So I only want to mention a couple of things. I'm hoping this is not just 2, 3, 4, 5 months of, you know, reshuffling the deck and sending you back the same exact plan. I ask that you direct your staff that the plan that comes back to you has to have more reductions from mobile sources than the plan that is before you today, whether it comes from regulatory measures, whether it comes from incentive measures. Let's put more reductions into this plan and move the ball forward, not just, oh, we went through it and, you know, nothing can be done and let's move forward. Let's direct the staff to amend the mobile source control strategy to take into account the 2021-2025 attainment deadline, as one of the board members suggested. Let's make this set the standard for the state. What we need in San Joaquin Valley, let's have that be the part. So if it takes 3 months or six months, let's do it. But one other issue that you have to be careful, and we all have to be careful, and I'm happy Rich said, let's communicate with the EPA. As we speak, I'm going around San Joaquin Valley talking to elected officials, warning them about potential sanctions on San Joaquin Valley. Because even if we got this, you know, extension, as you all saw, it is a very difficult plan to put together ultimately. So we're preparing the valley for facing the sanctions, for facing the federal implementation plan, which some people say would be months of no farm days, no drive days, and things like that. Valley needs to be ready to deal with that if we're not able to put a plan together. So let's communicate with EPA that we are working on this, because the sanction clock will not begin until EPA makes a formal finding that you failed to meet the deadline. So let's do everything we can working with EPA to make sure the sanction clock doesn't begin too quickly, because once the sanction clock begins, the FIP clock, you can never turn off till you're in attainment or meet the obligation. So let's make sure we don't put the valley's disadvantaged communities in jeopardy of losing billions of dollars and having EPA come here and say, let's shut down the freeways and the farms. So as long as we do that, I'm hoping that we can work together. One last point about contingencies. That's something that we have to be careful, because, you know, for people that, just look at this without, looking at the full impact, it's a little bit misleading, the contingency. You always want to have contingencies. But in an area where we've thrown the kitchen sink in the plant and we can still not show attainment, people that ask for contingency, what measures do they want us to hold back? To take it out and say, oh, let's not do it now. Let's save that for contingency for later. That, to me, is detrimental to air quality. That's why it has been a big problem for ARB, for South Coast, for us to meet the contingency requirements, because we're throwing everything in the mix. We're not saving something for later, so we don't have contingencies. It's hard to have contingencies when everything that you have already is not enough. So let's set the expectations correct. So hopefully your direction to the board, to the staff, would be, let's take our time, come back with a plan that moves the ball forward. Let's make sure the plan that comes back has more reductions from mobile sources, any reductions that we can get from stationary sources. Let's have a full public engagement about those rules and regulations that we have to do. But it's, as you saw, 85% of the pollution comes from mobile sources. So the plan coming back, hopefully, will have 85% more reductions from mobile sources. And with that, I encourage you to, as long as we can work with the sanction clock with EPA, to follow what Senator Flores has suggested by way of taking more time to do it right.
Thank you. Mrs. Berg, you had, I think, been taking notes busily here, and I think you had a thought about sort of process.
Yeah, thank you, Madam Chair. I would like to move to table are 16-9-5 and instruct ARB staff to prioritize an additional public review, including the district, with full public engagement, looking at our mobile source strategy, and coming back to the board February 2017 with a full review as to putting more detail behind the current moderate plan, along with explaining layering into the serious plan, as you indicated, Mr. Corey. We also would like to instruct that you would communicate, as you indicated, with US EPA to make sure we mitigate any consequences for taking the additional time, and really want to encourage all stakeholders, our health advocates, our community advocates, and our business advocates, because we know that those constituents keep this valley healthy, and we need to do that.
Okay, that's a motion that's on the table. Do we have
one question to clarify, and I understood it to be part of your direction in terms of the closer look at NOx and PM, direct PM reductions. It's mobile and stationary that we're looking at.
Not just mobile.
Right.
Correct.
Mobile and stationary.
So do we also want to talk about or include in the motion that advancement to 2025? Do we want to, that was suggested, you know, instead of looking as far out as 2031, we need these improvements in air quality by an earlier date,
an earlier
by 2025.
Date, yes.
I think we should also include that in the motion to look at that.
Yes, yes, that would be included, that we're looking specifically as to measures that can obtain by the 2025.
Does that meet the intent that you had, Mr. Flores?
Yeah, I mean, you can either include it in the moderate plan, or you can iterate towards the, you know, the larger extreme plan. But it seems to me if we start with the most immediate, that's more of a conversation, I think, with staff, local staff, and the groups who are affected. So it really, I think you phrased that right. Yeah. Second.
Thank you. That's what I was hoping for.
And does that assume benchmarks in between? Does that assume benchmarks? Do we have to add, would we need to add that to the motion?
Can you?
I don't think so. I think I'm clear that the report back to the board is the process in terms of the discovery of additional opportunities for NOx and PM, and then where do they live?
On a calendar, yeah. Some sort of a
thank
timeline.
You.
If that's yes. Mr. Eisenhut.
Not intending to add this to the motion, but in your notes, Mr. Corey, there's been discussion about making sure we explore possibilities for incentives, and while Ms. Mitchell's idea of a superfund is intriguing, it's not going to happen by February, I would just request that your notes include an emphasis on that as we move forward.
I think we all understand that incentives are an essential part of any package for attainment here. All right, without further ado then, I'm going to call for a vote on the motion. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstentions? Terrific. Thanks, everybody, for a very, very good discussion.